Now that it's no longer a global health emergency, what happens now to vaccines? People are asking, one, are they still going to be free? Number two, are we going to change our policy on booster shots? Because the Congresswoman, there was a point that many felt our booster shot policy was so strict that the regular population wanted their booster, but they couldn't yet because they were not in line. What should the new COVID vaccine policy be?
Yeah, it actually depends on the supply, Karen. And you're right. In vaccination, whenever the phase of infection is there, you have to aggressively provide the vaccines. What happened to our country? Not even the booster shot, even the primary series. Gusto na magpabakuna ng ating mga seniors. Ayaw pagbigyan kasi unahin mo nang ubusin yung ating healthcare workers. Siyempre, yung iba may sariling utak yun, may sariling paniniwala yun. And it took Congress to aggressively push the department during the time and to question Secretary Duque several times to really allow the A2 population. Parang wag mo nang hintayin ubusin yan, as long as the consideration will actually be the inventory. You are only strict with the coverage if you have a few vaccines.
Limited. Yeah.
Yes. And for private sector, that's their procurement. Let them use it, because vaccines, there's no vaccine overdose. You just curtail the use of vaccine because you don't want to waste vaccines. Parang vitamins yan eh. In excess of what you're taking, it just makes your urine expensive.
Is that so right? I was going to say, is that a fact, Congresswoman? I think that's a good point right now, because after the controversy we've had with vaccines, there's really no such thing as a vaccine overdose?
Yes. There's no such thing as vaccine overdose, but in excess, it won't have an additional benefit. So, hindi rin dapat sayangin. Kasi yung sinasayang mong bakuna, let's say if the recommendation is 3 doses, you have to stop at 3 doses because the 4th dose and the 5th dose will not have an added benefit unless you use it as a booster shot at the point of time where you already have waning immunity because of external factors.
Okay.
That's the real situation.
But do you believe that COVID-19 vaccines should still be free, even after the announcement?
Okay, for certain population, it should still be provided by our government. However, for the working class, we have to balance the budget of the government. We have a lot of programs, public health programs, that were sacrificed because of COVID. Mm-hmm. And let's say, for example, the flu vaccine. The flu vaccine is given to the indigent senior citizens. And later on, dapat nakukover lahat ng senior citizens. Mm-hmm. But then the working class, those who are continuously exposed, the health workers will be provided by the hospitals or the healthcare facility. But then, for the indigents, especially the seniors na marami ng maintenance yan, government is obliged to provide it. The same thing with COVID, like for cancer patients, renal patients, the senior citizens, and even for our HIV patients and those who have autoimmune disorders, it should be provided for free. Theoretically, maganda bigyan lahat ng diabetics, but the volume of diabetic patients is quite a lot.
Oo. Pero ang dami naman nating nabulok na COVID, di ba? Vaccines. Ang dami ring nag-expire, ma'am.
Kasi nga, pinahirapan ng todo. And we, Karen, I've been reaching out ever since on vaccination. Look at what happened to our country. Kung hindi ba naman grabe na ang tawag ng Kongreso, doon pa inalaw na mag-proceed sa next population. So, what's happening is that the decision makers, the strategists, or the policy directions are anchored towards what they read on scientific papers. You have to follow that, but you have to tweak it commensurate to the situation in our country. Pag sinabing ito yung prioritization, hindi naman ibig sabihin doon, ubusin muna yung first priority. Ang ibig lang sabihin noon, bigyan sila ng unang karapatan. However, let's say after a few weeks or a few months, if they don't want it, give it to the next population. For our booster shots, there was a huge demand for the first booster way back in July, especially among healthcare workers. But then we gave it on December. The second booster, pahirapan. And people were already having a difficulty because people were working. You know, Karen, we have to understand that you cannot take away a man's salary for that day simply because he wants to be vaccinated.
Okay, my last two questions for you. According to the World Health Organization, the Philippines is among the countries with the lowest vaccination rate for kids, for children. Now, you were once health secretary. So why is it that after all the administrations that had passed, why is it we still have a low vaccination rate for kids? How could policies improve? Yeah.
Because of the misinformation. Unfortunately, in our country, the anti-vaxxers has been given a huge voice. And this has created a scare among vaccinologists and the experts related to immunology and infectious disease control. How do we solve it? What can actually be done is to allow the use of these vaccines among pediatric clinics. Well, the schools will be a very timely venue for vaccination. However, if you want to start it slow, then the government vaccine, especially for pediatric patients, can be given for free to the pediatric clinics, including the supplies, para walang dagdag singil.
And I wanted to ask you, I know that a week ago, a judge in Quezon City dropped the Denvaxia case. Is this the latest update that we have?
Well, yes, the problem with the Denvaxia case is every time a case is dismissed, then the complainants wouldn't accept it. And every time a judge proceeds with the case, kasi ganun naman ang kaso, dapat pakinggan natin and
but
resolve
it. You must somehow feel vindicated, right?
Well, Karen, when the pandemic came, all the vaccinologists were called. A few of us, unfortunately, died during the pandemic. But with the anemic number of trained vaccinologists in the world, everybody was called to do their job. Unfortunately, those who were also doing COVID vaccination in the Philippines ended up with a lot of cases.
Yeah,
it was not publicized, but then they should be protected by government. Yeah. And I believe all of this
is... You pointed that out before, because you had said before, I believe, it's hard for cabinet secretaries, or specifically when it comes to health, for you to push for something if what you fear is a case will be filed against you resulting from a decision that you've made. Now, just to move forward from this, my last question is, President Marcos Jr. has been doing well on several fronts, and yet there is still no agriculture secretary, there's still no health secretary. How important is it that he already assigns and appoints a health secretary?
Well, it's very important. When I was appointed as a secretary of health, I stayed as OIC for a long time, several months. I think almost a year. I was about to end my term when I was appointed. But I believe USEC Secretary Roset Verheri needs. I believe she does not have the confidence to police people in the department. That's a problem. She has to be confident because she has to. She was given full powers.
Yeah.
Or if she stays as USEC or as OIC secretary, she has to be told, okay, you will be OIC until the end of this year. Because I believe the uncertainty that hangs in her head is she doesn't know if she will be removed anytime tomorrow or the next week. So the programs are not moving.
Okay. On that note, we don't have enough time, but it's been a pleasure to have you here. Thank you so much, Congresswoman Janet Garin. Hope to see you soon.
Thank you, Karen. Have a blessed day. Maraming salamat.
All right.